If you want to pump your body and expand your mind, there's only one place to go. Mind Pump. Mind Pump. With your hosts, Sal DiStefano, Adam Schaefer, and Justin Andrews.
In this episode of Mind Pump, for the first 22 minutes, me, Adam, and Justin have some fun conversation. We talk about our favorite generation, millennials.
Yeah, good, they are our favorite.
Actually,
yeah.
we really do
we
like them.
We pick on them and we lift them up.
They're good kids.
Yeah. Don't miss out on the Netflix cartoon Big Mouth.
Yeah, we talk about Big Mouth.
I can't wait. I'm watching it tonight.
We talk about puberty, raging hormones. I thought I was going to say boners. Raging hormones. And we
got excited.
We do talk about boners. We talk about Beyond the Barbell becoming one of our go-to podcasts. We actually hung out with the hosts of Beyond the Barbell. Great guys.
Yeah, awesome guys.
And then we had some fun conversation about me being coached by my girlfriend Jessica and the way we choose
and
the music.
The music. Yeah. It was special.
Sometimes you got to lift weights to That's the saxophone.
We're really proud of you, Sal.
We are.
We mentioned our sponsor, Thrive Market. So if you go to thrivemarket.com/mindpump, here's what's going to happen. You're going to get 1 month free membership. You're going to get $20 off your first three orders of $49 or more, and you're going to get free shipping. Basically, they're losing money on you. So get on there and take advantage of this
before they pull it out.
Before it goes away. And then we get into the questions. So the first question is, should you go into business with a family member? Is that a smart idea? No. Next question is...
Horrible idea.
Yeah, exactly. Can you achieve a high level of health even if you can't afford to buy organic? Obviously, this person is not familiar with Thrive Market because the prices are ridiculous. But we do talk about...
Yeah, they figured it out.
We talk about the benefits of organic and really weighing them out. And the second part of that question was it better to consume, you know, produce that's got tons of pesticides or eat the standard American diet, as if those are the only two choices?
Yeah.
The third question was...
That's like saying, like, I'm on an island. I have two choices to eat.
Yeah.
This or this.
Yeah, no, there's more choices. The third question was, what are our thoughts on the growing popularity of nootropic foods? I actually saw a protein bar the other day that was infused with nootropics.
Oh, that's so great.
Yeah, it's getting in everything. And then finally, how long does it take for you to start to lose muscle when you stop training? That's actually a very good question. We have a great discussion with that particular one. Also, we've been getting a lot of questions recently about our Build Your Butt Bundle. People are asking us what that's all about. So here's what it is. The Build Your Butt Bundle takes MAPS Anabolic and MAPS Aesthetic, two of our most popular programs, and it combines them and discounts the price. But what we also done is we've also included a modification where we teach you movements, exercises, techniques, and programming to get your glutes to connect and fire so that when you do your squats or you do your deadlifts or you do your lunges or, you know, all those other good butt building exercises, that your butt actually builds instead of, you know, I just do all these squats and my butt doesn't respond, but I'm getting these big quads.
Fix that sleepy butt, girl.
Fix that sleepy butt and
yeah,
guy.
Girl.
Some dudes want them big booty.
Mainly girl.
Yeah. So that's what the Build Your Butt Bundle is. It's those two programs with a modification, and we've discounted everything. I think it's over 20% off. All you got to do to enroll is go to mindpumpmedia.com, find the Build Your Butt Bundle, click on it, and sign up now. Yeah. Can I tell you something? People, there's a lot of shit talk, and we've even done it jokingly about millennials, but can I tell you something right now? I have not. This generation is more inventive and more entrepreneur-minded than our generation was. For sure.
Well, when you look at...
For sure.
Because the tools are changing the whole game.
It's,
like, everything
it's
needs...
And it's cool.
Yeah, everything needs invention right now.
But it's cool to be an entrepreneur.
Well, we're part of Google, Facebook era.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the mantra there. I mean, that's totally... They encourage all this... You know, they want this creative freedom and flexibility, and they're
working with people.
Yes,
as opposed
yes.
to doing your own thing.
If you know anything about how they structure their work environment... It's totally designed
it's the
group
around.
Mind. Yeah, it's definitely the group mind, and these guys are very. But here's the thing, though. Here's the knock. I'm going to come back at you with this. Is that, you know, it sounds really cool and exciting, like when they come up with all these ideas and stuff, but it the percentage still applies. Yeah. That freaking 90% of them will fail. It just it's cool to see the energy at that young of an age.
And like, and there's a little bit of a selection bias, considering these are so far what we're talking about is people who are interning with us or are contracting with us, and these kids are just they're hungry, they're smart, they're creative, they want to learn, they also want to grow. And I don't know about you guys, but I cannot help but like just fall in love with these kids. When these kids come in here, like I have such a like Drew, like, you know, he's just this young kid doing our editing, like so like upbeat and has all these ideas. And Jordan,
yesterday he was telling me all about how he's learning neuroscience and all that, you know, in class, getting all fired up.
Just want to hug him.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? want to get him a headlock.
Yeah, so cute.
Yeah, get him a little headlock.
Just keep that energy high before you get squashed by life. You know what I mean? Keep it up. Go travel. Get shit out of your system.
He was, what was he
You'll never get it again. He was get a fucking real job that you have to stay in.
Yeah,
you can't get up and travel. Do all the shit that you like love to do.
Justin's right. A little jealous.
Totally. That's just coming out. I had to like, you know.
It's funny when they're
like the Exorcist.
And who is it? Was it Drew? He was talking about how like he was talking to some girl or was going to talk to some girl, and immediately I'm like, no girls. Like, don't waste your time on girls, bro.
Yeah,
he'll fucking
slow you
be
down.
Be a champion. There's plenty of time for girls.
You're doing so much right now.
Yeah. Don't worry about the girls.
Meanwhile, his hormones are telling, fuck you. Have you guys seen the cartoon Big Mouth yet?
No.
Oh, my God. I think I saw Netflix.
Oh, my, yes.
I saw a little bit of that.
I haven't watched it yet.
Oh, it's terrible. Great or what?
Just watch 5 minutes of it.
It's terrible.
It is terrible.
I'm trying to remember it, though.
Hilarious.
I just remember it was terrible.
Well, it's so the whole cartoon, it's a cartoon, right? It's very South Park-ish, right? It's got that type of crude humor.
Uh-huh.
But it's the whole cartoon is about teenage boys and girls.
Oh, yes, yes,
going
yes, yes.
through puberty.
Oh, yeah, I saw the first episode.
So periods and boners and like that is, and
there's
masturbation
this,
is like the whole thing is around
there's
that.
There's this one scene. So it's these two, like the first episode, which is like what I saw, is like these two kind of nerdy kids, and one of the guys is going through puberty before the other guy, and he gets out of the shower, and his buddy, he sees his buddy's dick, and he's like, what the fuck? And his buddy covers up, and he's all like self-conscious, like, dude, it's so big and hairy, like, mine doesn't look like that. And then on the flip side, the same guy is going through puberty. They depict his horniness as this like hormone monster that comes out.
Yeah, and it's a big giant dick. It's a big giant.
I swear to God, I had this idea.
It's a big giant dick, and it's like talking.
He's like in class, right? He's sitting in class, and the monster comes up, and he's like, "Hey, what's up, buddy?" He's like, "Not in here, man. I'm in class." He's like, "Come on, man. Let's go to the bathroom."
I swear to God, that's so funny because I had this like skit idea of like this kid that what gave this idea was, remember Teen Wolf? Like, I like amounted it to like being like, you know, as you're going through puberty, like it was like this monster that like you turned into, like, and you like you walked around
dude,
a raging boner,
Justin,
and
you
smelled
will
bad,
love,
and
the
you're
show.
Hairy.
You will love the show. Yeah. Katrina actually really likes it. I think we've watched 3 or 4 episodes now. We typically put it on.
My dude, God. That already won me.
The
over
The one
right
scene
there.
That killed me, bro, was he slept over his friend's house, so he's on the floor in the sleeping bag, and his buddy's in bed.
There's so many stories I know and everybody can relate to.
He's in his buddy's room, right, and then the hormone monster comes out. He's like, "Hey, man, your buddy, he's sleeping right now. Why don't you come on? Why don't you rub one out?" And he's like, "No, man, I'm in my friend's room. I can't be doing."
He's like, "Come on, man, go away."
And he's like, "Hey, look at." He's like, "I don't remember what he said."
There's
like,
a clock. There was a kitty clock.
Oh yeah, there was a kitty clock. He's like, "Look at that kitty clock." Like, because you know when you're that age, everything like, turns on.
Yeah,
look at that dirty little
bang.
Pussy.
Yeah. It's because it was a cat
just
clock.
Like anything.
So he like jerks off and next to his buddy, and then the next day his friend was kind of weird to him. He's like, "Oh fuck, did he see me? Did he see me?" Like, God damn it.
Why is he acting all weird?
It's funny because it's obviously comedy, but you can relate so much.
Oh, it's extremely inappropriate, so it's not for kids whatsoever, but it's fucking hilarious.
Okay, I'm watching that tonight.
It's super crude.
I'm into it.
That to me, the kid going through puberty and the whole relationship.
Dude, it's so true.
Yeah, like every boy that went through puberty, it struggled. There's definitely a scene in there that you'll go like, oh, I remember. There's a dance.
I remember.
And they do the other side with the girl too. So the girl like gets her period and she's wearing white shorts at like some field trip and shit. It's super graphic too, dude. It's like over the top.
Dude, I remember distinctly, like, because I would go to work with my dad in the morning, so it's like early in the morning. I'm like, I don't know, 13. We're driving in his like big van. He used to drive this big work van, right? Mm-hmm. This big old like, you know, loud van. And we're driving to the work, and I'm half asleep. And it's like, you're just getting boners, like, for no reason, all the time.
Yeah.
And you're in a car with your dad.
Yeah, that's,
you know what I'm saying? Okay. I used to get so mad, like, what the fuck's wrong with
me? I told you I had a boner when I was at a funeral.
And no,
like,
no.
It was like somebody I knew, and I was like, sad and everything, and I had a boner, and it was so confusing. I was like, no, why?
That's why this show is so great, because it's that conversation that you're having with yourself at moments like that, and they made a cartoon out of it, and it's just fucking, it's called Big Mouth on Netflix, and I don't know how I came across it, but
that's great.
It's freaking hilarious.
Those were the days.
I know.
Those were the days
when life was simple, when all you had to think about was, what was
bro, when I was today? When I ugh, when I was, I mean, five times a day, when I was like 13 years old, I actually got, which is kind of common in boys going through puberty, I got a little bit of gynecomastia at 13 years old.
Oh, really?
I did, and I went to the doctor.
Is it too much masturbating?
What? No, because I had
his estrogen levels were trying to keep up with all the testosterone being pumped out.
I went to the doctor. And I remember, and it was very mild, like, but I remember asking the doctor, like, what is it? Like, what's going on? And the doctor's like, oh, that's normal. Your testosterone. Like, my testosterone levels went from 0 to 5 million.
It was like overload.
Overnight, dude. Yeah. Overnight. It was terrible.
I felt the same way, too.
Yeah.
I remember being a kid and
my son's.
I distinctly remember when it happened. When I noticed that too. Like when I was in jazzercise. Like, so my mom would drag me to jazzercise and I had to sit there and wait.
What? You really been in a jazzercise?
I had to like wait until the whole class was done and I'm sitting there and she'd give me some toys or something to play with or whatever.
Toys? Well, how old are you?
He's like 17.
Yeah, it wasn't toys. It was reading. I don't remember.
Here you go, Jesse. Here's some Lincoln Logs. Yeah. Mom's gonna go do her jazzercise. I'll be right back.
13 years old.
12. Yeah.
Hey, we brought some Legos.
Here's some Legos. Here, stack them up. I had to wait till anyway. So I was waiting until the class is over, and then just one class in particular was like, whoa, this like rush of like feelings I've never felt. Like if all the girls dancing around. Yeah, it happened.
Oh.
Yeah. Well, the weirdest moments would always be when it would come on as a kid when you were in a situation there was nothing hot or sexy about
that's
it.
The worst.
Yeah,
because then you think
you're hanging out with your mom and dad and it's just like, oh my god, this is disgusting right now. Like, I'm with my mom and dad right now.
It's bad.
Oh, it was terrible. I mean,
but every boy went through that.
It was terrible, but looking back, right, what a gift. Like, could you imagine if you had that ability? Imagine if you had that ability as a 35-year-old, 40-year-old male.
Yeah.
Oh my! Actually, it'd probably be torturous.
Yeah,
it'd still be torturous.
It'd be torturous.
It'd be cool for a weekend.
Don't you remember how torturous it was as a young boy? I remember driving my girlfriend crazy as a high school kid.
Yeah.
Just all I want to do is kiss and touch boobs and grab ass and like. I remember to a point just where it just hug. Enraged me. Like it enraged me. Like I would just be angry. Like that. Like we just didn't mess around all the time. Like that's all you want to do as a 17-year-old
boy.
That's
why the Hulk made sense to me.
Yeah.
Like, I on several occasions hurt myself. That's how bad it was. Several occasions caused damage to myself because it was too
cranking
frequent.
Too hard or
too
what?
Much.
Oh yeah.
It was too much. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Call that gator dick.
what do you call it?
After three. Anything after three is just, too much, dude.
Yeah, after three. But it was just but that's a lot of testosterone wasted on the young.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Absolutely.
Wasted on the young. So anyway.
How'd you what'd you guys think about our boys from Beyond Barbell, man?
Beyond the Barbell. Great dudes,
yeah,
like really, really cool
super
guys.
Super smart, super cool, like
very intelligent guys. I really enjoyed talking to them about coaching and personal training and business because they understand the intricacies of leadership and personal training on a very, very high level.
Mm-hmm.
I was very impressed with the way that they describe things and explain things, and they both come across as two gentlemen with lots of integrity, which I really, really like. So. Really cool, man. I can't wait to... We'll see what happens with that episode.
It's just exciting to meet people. Like, I guess from the old guard, they're kind of describing like the true mentality of it, you know, going into the games and everything else, and then kind of what happened as a result of the popularity and all that kind of stuff. So,
yeah, CrossFit's an interesting phenomenon, isn't it? Just an interesting phenomenon, how it grew, and they seem to believe that it's kind of reached a peak and it's kind of plateaued a little bit in terms of its growth.
Oh, I think a lot of people think... Well, statistically, you can look it up as far as the success of clubs. I mean, ever since like your Orange Theories and stuff now, I mean, those, they're definitely taking a piece of that pie. Before, just 5 years ago, CrossFit had that pie to themselves, and now, and not only, Orange Theory is just one example of many other places that are trying to take that model. They did it first. They exploded. Mm-hmm. And now you're starting to see everybody else is kind of taking a page out of this, like, oh, okay, this small. I mean, we just were looking at photos of that Red Dot place, which is similar type of deal. You're trying to create this little small atmosphere where you feel connected to your members and build the culture there. It's smart, and there's a lot of good to it. I think that we have gotten away from that with big box gyms. You know, I know that there, most people don't talk to each other in that, and I don't think that's healthy for us as humans.
No, the big box gym went wrong. They did. They really took a turn which opened the door for other businesses. You know, like the successes of CrossFit in particular with the female market and with exercise selection, like, you know, deadlifts and squats and the effective movements, was directly the result of the failure of what the gyms were failing at.
The avoidance of those types of exercises.
The gyms did a shit job of getting women to lift weights. They did a shit job of it. Just terrible. Mm-hmm. CrossFit single-handedly in 10 years did more than the gyms did in, you know, 30 years in terms of getting women to actually want to lift weights, which I think is phenomenal. It's absolutely phenomenal. So I'll give them credit all day long with that.
Yeah, no. You know, I struggle, though, because I could never do class settings like that. I could never do a class, no matter what.
It's a tough monster.
It is. It's just, I love and enjoy my headphones and my piece and lifting by myself.
Oh, I suit yourself for your own workouts?
Yeah. Like, I'm not that type of, I know, and I can't be alone, right? There's got to be other personalities that are like mine where, I don't want to talk to fucking Susie and James, every Monday when we're all sweating together. Like, no, that's not me. Like, I'm good with my relationships. If anything, I need to spend more time with those that I already love. Like, I don't need to add more people into my.
Are we just assholes then?
No, it's just to me. I
feel the same way.
We're like fitness Grinches.
Yeah.
No, I just think I think I have built my
humbug.
I have built my 1 hour a day of training as into my, part of kind of my meditation. I think I've also included other forms of true meditation, but it's always been a happy place for me, a recovery type.
I agree.
It's always been that space for me, and I don't want to share it. I mean, it's even like Katrina and I, when we live together, she respects that with me. It's like, I still wear my headphones. Like, I'm not talking to her. Like, I like encourage her. Hey, if you want to lift with me and you want to do what I'm doing, absolutely. And of course I'm watching her and stuff, but she's got great mechanics. So to me, it's like, that's my space and that's my time. And I like to be by myself.
So I totally agree with you. I love working out alone. I love, you know, putting my headphones on or getting into my space. But I tell you what, man, I've been working out with, now me and Jessica, when we work out together, we work out together and we coach each other. And
you let her coach you?
You know what's great about it? Absolutely.
Wow.
You know why it's awesome? First off, having another pair of eyes on you is always great. Number two, you know, when I train, I'm always have a tendency to let my ego take over a little bit or not judge a lift and she'll check me. And it's, I respect her in that sense because she's a great, in her own right, she's an excellent trainer. She understands biomechanics very well. She understands imbalances very well. So she'll give me some advice. And if I find that I get, and this is my own personal growth, if I find that I'm like, no, I'm not going to do it, you know, then I ask myself, like, why am I so resistant to what she's, you know.
So did you find
you're challenging that? That's pretty big.
Absolutely.
Dude.
Yeah. No, I'm very surprised. And by the way, Jessica, that's not a knock on you as a trainer. That's just I'm surprised that Sal even allows that to happen. So did you, when you first started doing this, did you struggle with that? Did she like the very first time? Like, there had to have been a time, right, where she'd never said anything before. You guys worked out, then all of a sudden she says, "Hey, your hips are rising a little too fast on your deadlift."
So I would. So it happened like this. When I first started working out with her, I was coaching her a lot more than she was coaching me. Then when we would incorporate flexibility stuff, I would have her coach me a lot because she's a wizard when it comes to that. Just from her experience traveling with the Cirque du Soleil and training with all these like expert acrobats or whatever. So I would have her help me with that kind of stuff. And then she's such a sponge. She learns so quickly that I would start asking her questions like, hey, when I'm squatting, can you keep an eye on my hips or my knees? Let me know what this looks like or what do you notice here? And she would point them out like, okay, at the bottom of the squat, you're shifting to the left, or it looks like your knees are going in, or your feet, especially my feet. I'd say, watch my feet, because I was always a tough one. And she'd be like, okay, your feet are pronating. So I would use her cues. I would cue her to give me cues. But now we've been working out so long together that, you know, if she's going to give me advice, I'm going to definitely consider it. And, you know, it's another pair of eyes for somebody that I trust.
So you never really struggled with it then? You never really had a time where you're just like, rawr.
You know where I struggle? I'll struggle when it comes to the pace of the workout, the intensity, because sometimes I think differently, like, no, we need to move at this pace or whatever. And here's a big one. This is the one thing that we argue about when we work out, music. The one thing, because, and so now we've
age old war members in the gym.
She likes, okay, so here's the deal. Like, when I work out, I don't work out to music I like to chill and listen to. That's different music. The music I like to sit and listen to is nice music. It's fun. It can be great, whatever. When I lift, I want to lift to music that makes me fucking angry.
Charge you.
Yeah, I want to be fucking, Rage Against the Machine, Lamb of God, you know, like Sepultura. Like, I want to be.
Yeah.
She hates that shit. Like, most people, like a lot of people do, but most women do. Yeah. Doesn't like it.
It's probably more distracting for her.
No, she likes to listen to, you know, like music that you would listen to. Like, she likes to enjoy the music. I'm like, no, I can't lift to that. Like, that's not. So we compromise to where she'll pick music on some days and pick music.
Now it's just Yanni.
On other days. And the one genre that we can both lift to is 90s rap. Because then I can...
I'm picturing this right
now.
Yeah,
so am I, dude. And so I got the same picture right now. I'm laughing right now. I'm picturing Sal with his shirt off in the garage with this girl stretching in the splits position.
Wearing MC Hammer pants.
And Too Legit to Quit is in the background.
No, like Tupac or Dr. Dre, you know what I'm saying?
No.
But you, popular.
But, yeah, exactly.
Like Vanilla Ice shit. Yeah.
Exactly.
That's what I see.
Exactly. Yeah. That's the only music.
See the gangster.
That's the only music we both can like lift hard to. You know what I'm saying?
Young MC.
Tone Loke.
Yeah. Belle Biv DeVoe.
Mama said, knock you out.
Actually.
Hip hop, hooray. Hey.
Damn it, OPP. You know sound.
Damn, that's a jam.
All day.
Actually, this morning we had an argument over it because she's like, she hooks her phone up and she's like, all right, I'm going to put music on. I'm like, no.
You got yesterday.
I'm like, yeah, today's a heavy day. Like, that's my workout day. She's like, no. You said that I would. And I'm like, oh, whatever, put your music on. So she's like, fine, we'll put yours on. I'm like, why? She's like, because I don't like to listen to my music if I know you're fucking hating it. And then what happens is,
oh, man.
Yeah. Dude, God bless your soul, bro. God bless your soul.
You know what happens?
Because even that conversation right
that's
there.
That's it. I'm done.
That's right.
On,
right. That's
no,
you know, kudos to you, dude, because after that conversation, you're out. That's it. Yeah. You were in.
You made a lot of personal growth.
You were in.
We appreciate
it. You were into the workout. Now you're out of the workout.
I would not
have
patience.
Now you work out by yourself.
No, it's hilarious. You know what it is? Is because I'm an asshole. If I do let her put, if she does put music on, then what I'll do is I'll make fun of the music while we're working out.
Oh, no.
Yeah, so I'm a dick.
That move with movies.
You know what I mean?
My wife cannot watch anything.
She'll be like, come on.
She knows.
She'll be like, come on. Just let me. I want to listen to country. Like, please. I'm like, all right, that's cool. Yeah, I can put country on. It's fine. You can do. Yeah. Then while it's on, I'll be making fun of it, you know, singing it along and joking around. She's like, it's not the same.
Yeah. I ruined the whole Twilight series for my wife.
Did you?
Yeah.
I'm like,
I'm a fucking vampire and I glitter. That's my power. You know, she's like, shut up.
Yeah. Being observant.
Yeah, just being
this is what they have. This is what they have to offer.
Just being
I had Lost Boys. Yeah. You have this. What is this?
So anyway, so this morning we worked out to Rage Against the Machine.
Yeah. You won the argument.
That was tomorrow she gets the
now
pick.
Does she pout when you do that or is she good? She's solid.
No, she's cool. She's totally, she's down. She'll listen to it and work out, but tomorrow we're gonna listen to like, I'm pretty sure we're gonna listen to like Jubel or Haim or something like that.
Which is
good music, but it's not lifting music.
What is that? I don't even know what that is.
It's like kind of like I don't know how to explain. Like, Haim is like, it's like pop kind of. Actually, love their music. I love them. They're like some of my favorite artists. I just don't lift weights to them. And then Jubel's kind of like, it's almost like trancey, but not, you know, I don't know how to explain it. I'll have to play some music.
Yeah, dude, you got me lost right now. Huh. I want a picture of what you
got.
I
hate that I don't know like music.
You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to pull up one of their songs.
You have to.
So you guys can see.
Because I want to hear what this music sounds
like. I feel like an old man now.
I need to try and picture myself in the garage lifting to something like this.
Yeah.
Let's see.
For sure.
I think
let's all get to this place.
I think this is the song that she always likes to listen to. Hold on 1 second. We'll wait for it to start playing. Yeah, right here. She loves this fucking group right here.
Okay.
It's really,
but does it have a breakdown at least?
No, dude, you listen. I mean? Like, it's good music. You want to make love to it. I'm not trying to lift to it. You know
are you like deadlifting at this point? Or
no, what? This is for trigger days, bro. I get the foundational workout days.
I'm sorry.
You know what I'm saying? I can't do it.
It's you know what?
Music. I heard a saxophone in there.
I can't do it.
Sal gets the award. You're the better. Yeah. You're the better man.
Yeah,
this year.
Man. You got patience award of the
2017
year.
Man right. of the year right. from Mind right. Pump stepping Media. Up. Sal wins. Sal wins the award. For
I tell
this
you
one.
What. I
the
because
one award
I
give you.
Yeah, because I value it. I get something out of it too. So you got to give. You got to give some to get yeah. some.
Oh wow! That's yeah, wow! Bring on the sensitive bird. Yeah.
It, workouts lead to sex sometimes. So I gotta...
This quaz brought to you by Organifi. For those days you fall short on getting your organic veggies or whole food nutrition, Organifi fills the gap with laboratory-tested, certified organic superfoods to help give your health and performance the added edge. Try Organifi totally risk-free for 60 days by going to Organifi.com. That's Organifi.com. And use the coupon code MINDPUMP for 20% off at checkout.
First up is Santa GT. He's going into business with his brother, and he's extremely nervous. Any tips in getting into business with family?
Yeah don't do it.
Don't.
I think that I think it's an extremely bad idea. I think if you're actually asking a question about it, that's an even another cue that you're
flag.
You're
flag.
Already telling yourself.
Isn't that
fine.
Like business rule number one?
Yeah. Well,
never get into business with family.
Now that that being said,
or a significant other.
I have a sister that works for the company, but here's...
But you're not partners.
Well, yeah, we're not partners. And not only that, but we make a conscious effort to separate her from me. So I am in no communication. So she works for our company, and I don't even communicate with her ever about business. And there, it's put into place for that reason, because I don't ever want... her doing a good job or a bad job ever to affect my love for her as a sister. And that's inevitable if you work in a company. Like, there's definitely times where I guarantee that it doesn't go perfect, something that she's supposed to do. And if I was having to directly manage her, that would be a lot of stress for me, because if she was just a normal person and not my sibling, I'd probably rip her ass or fire over it. So, you got to understand that you got a business to run, but then you also have your love for your family. Those are not two things that mix well.
You
got
to create those boundaries right away, huh?
Here's the first tip I'll give you. If you're going to do it, you're going to go into business with your brother or your family member. Here's tip number one, don't do it. But if you're going to do it, this is what you need to do. Be very explicit and write everything out in your agreement. Make sure it's on contract.
Yeah.
What I'm responsible for, what you're responsible for. If this doesn't happen, this happens.
That piece right there.
Put that shit in writing.
That piece is so important that
you can reference it.
You separate too, and this will, you'll force you to also have to learn to let go of parts of the business. Like, you just have to agree that, okay, Mikey, you run the finances, the marketing, and any sort of onboarding of employees or members, whatever the hell you're doing, right? And then I'm going to run, any content creation, any sort of, business relationships or whatever. But you need to make sure that you have your silos that you run, and you don't dip into his and he doesn't dip into yours.
And spell out an exit plan in your paperwork when you first start your business.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Do not wait to write up the paperwork after you guys are making money. You've already fucked. You're screwed.
Yeah.
Do it before a single dime is made, before anybody invests anything. Literally spell out what percentage they own, what percentage you own, what percentage of the profit we get, how much we're going to spend, who's in control what. And if one of us wants to boot the other one, what is the process? And if one of us wants to leave, what is the process? Spell that shit out. So, and then make sure you talk to each other and say, look, this is business. It's not going to get in between our, as family, it's going to be in writing, and whatever happens, we're going to follow this. We're not going to let feelings get in, because otherwise you're fucked.
If you do a good job doing that, what Sal's saying right now, I think if you really think it all out, like, okay, let's look at worst case scenario. We do this business for a while, it doesn't take off, and then, but one guy wants to fight and keep it along, the other guy doesn't want to. What does that scenario look like? How do we handle that? And if you write it on paper and you agree to it together, I think
it eliminates so much.
It eliminates that. It's like, oh, here we are. This situation did end up happening. Of course, you don't want that to happen, but it's inevitable. Something's going to happen, including what do we do if this thing ends up being huge and we're making tons of money and we eventually have to hire more employees? Who's going to be responsible for what? Who makes so much what? So you got to definitely communicate.
It's almost exactly the same advice I give to somebody that's trying to get married. I mean, it's, it's
don't,
like,
don't, number one, don't do it.
Yeah, don't do it. Number two, if you're going to do it, you want X, Y, and B, everything else talked about, considered, and written down on a legal contract.
Yeah, because I think people go into it and they're like, oh, but we're family. Like, we'll figure it out. Like, we're friends.
You get along so well. So.
Yeah, and no, that's a huge, because then what ends up happening almost every time is the business starts to, you guys listen, are grinding, and one of them is like, fuck, you know, I'm doing all the work. Or the other one says, I put in all the money.
Somebody resents somebody.
Yeah. Listen, my
sister and I are the best of friends and have an incredible relationship. And part of the reason why I think we have an incredible relationship is because of having the foresight to make decisions like that, to make sure. Because, you know, Sal makes fun of me all the time for being moody. I absolutely am affected by this business and what we're currently doing
in
it.
Such good adjective for you.
Right. Yeah. If things are not going well, I'm sometimes a pain in the ass to be around. And you better believe if, you know, my sister was dropping the ball on something or around me or I had to communicate to on a daily basis, you know, I might not be the most awesome person to be around. So I would not even want to put myself in that situation. So I think you got to understand how, if you really love your sibling, you want to make sure that you think it all the way through on all the worst case scenarios that could happen in this situation and communicate them early. So you each agree and know. And I think then it's possible. I don't think it's not possible. I think there's plenty of exceptions to the rule of people that have built businesses or companies with a family or a loved one.
You look at your family dynamic. This is important now. Let's say you and your brother, you guys grew up together, right? So who tends to be the big brother or the leader and who tends to be the follower? Talk about that. Talk about it. Spell it out, because that can be very difficult to deal with when you're in business with your big brother who is used to being the dude in charge, but you're the one who has the ideas. You're the one driving the business.
Behind the operation.
Like, he might not deal with that very well. So sit down and spell it out. Like, look, you know, John or Mikey or whatever, look, I know, you know, you're my big brother or whatever, but I think I'm better in this particular way, you know. And I tell you what, if this preliminary talk that we're talking about goes bad, there's your sign. Like, if you can have a business talk with your brother and you can sit down and spell shit out and say, look, you know, I'm better at this, so I'm going to do that. And you guys are cool with it and you sign everything and it's all, that's a good sign. But if you sit there and you start arguing over that kind of bullshit right out the gates, then you already, you know, like, this ain't going to be cool, because I guarantee you're going to encounter some challenges with your business where you're going to want to strangle each other, and it being close to each other like brother, you know, brothers are, that just adds a whole nother element of difficulty. So
next up is Jess G. Veggie. Can someone achieve a high level of health even if they can't afford to purchase organic? Is it better to consume pesticide-laden produce or just eat like all the other Americans?
So there's two questions here. The first one, it used to be, if you wanted to eat organic, you had to spend a lot more money. And what I used to tell people was this, was look, it's definitely an investment in your health. It will save you money long term to be healthy, cost you less in both in productivity. It'll cost you less in healthcare costs. It's going to make you feel better. It's give you a better quality of life. If you eliminate some of the other things you spend money on, like your daily Starbucks or whatever, you can save the money. But today,
you have companies like Thrive Market,
that's right,
that are coming in and they're solving this problem. Like, that's what, I mean, that was part of the why we were so excited to partner with these guys, is they're going to be around for a while and they're going to make a huge dent in this exact, that's the biggest problem in the past was, oh my God, I can't eat organic because I'm broke. But now that they're getting rid of that, to where I can buy almost anything through Thrive Market at the grocery store that's comparable or even less than like your standard Safeway, Save Mart type foods, but it's all organic and sort. I mean, you can't now. It's just, now it's really just an excuse that we're using, right? Because I'm too lazy to go through the process or go down to a farmer's market, right? Because there's your other option if you don't want to go.
It's all there if you're interested in it now. Like, if you're pursuing quality, and I think it's just, you have to you have to prioritize these things as far as like importance. Like, do I want to fill my body up with things that are actually nourishing me, or am I just, you know, mindlessly kind of like getting calories in, calories out, and I'm monitoring it that way? You know, like you have to start thinking like long term about like the health ramifications. Like, what am I putting into my body?
I tell you what, this is how it works with Thrive Market. You pay a membership fee. I think it's a one-time fee, and then you get access to all these organic non-GMO products for really, really low prices, like what you would normally pay for a conventional product. So if you compare it to its non-organic version, like if you get organic Cheerios versus non-organic, normally the organic version is more expensive, but at Thrive Market, it's not going to be. But one thing that they did that I really like, well, first off, if you use our code, which we'll, I'm sure we told you at the beginning of this episode, you'll get discounts and all that stuff. But what I really like about this is sometimes even that membership fee is difficult, you know, for families, right? If you're disenfranchised or single parent, you know, I can't pay a membership fee or go on the line and order these things. Well, what they do is for every membership that they sell, they give a free one to a family in need. So what I like about all this is the obvious, but what I like more about it is what it's showing is that the market is moving in this direction. So this kind of a question won't be a question in the near future. You're not going to hear it. It used to be all the time.
I don't even think it's a question now. I think, and here's the thing, and this is hard for a lot of people to swallow. Like, it's okay to accept that I'm just not ready. I'm just not ready to make those sacrifices for yourself. Like, and in other words, more than likely, because at least in my experience, I have yet to meet a client who's given me this as an excuse that I can't find somewhere where they're wasting the same amount of money in other things, whether it be entertainment, whether it be sodas, coffees every single day, candy habits, whatever the fuck it is. There's something else in their life that's not serving them the same way that eating healthier would serve them, that they're making a choice. And that's fucking okay. It's your life. Do what you want with it. But when I get people to ask me questions like that, I always put it back on them and say, listen, there's now, we have resources like Thrive Market, like Farmers Market. There are things, and we were just talking offline the other day about how much we've seen Farmers Markets pop up. It's crazy. I remember that used to be something that you never saw, or once a month, or once, or I mean, there's one going every day now here in the city. I mean, you can find one somewhere. So there's, and now they even have these places too, where it's a straight farm to, where they give you the, have you seen, you guys
those
ever done
boxes?
The, yeah, the boxes, right, and yeah. It's all whatever's.
CSAs, my wife and I do that.
Yeah, right. So, I mean, there's sources out there. It's just, and I think Thrive Market is making it very easy for everybody.
You just have to prioritize it, because I see a lot of people with cell phones and cell phone bills, and people with, you know, cable and all these other extra expenditures. You just have to prioritize it. But now that it's not that much more expensive, or not more expensive at all, it's true. There is no excuse. Now, the second question was a ridiculous question. Is it better to consume pesticide-laden produce or eat a standard American diet? I don't like questions like that, because it's
either
or. Yeah, it's this either fair. Or, and it's like first off,
how about neither?
Yeah, why do we need to choose either one? First of all, the standard American diet is horrible.
Yeah.
It's horrible on a macro level. It's horrible.
It's just ridiculous.
On a calorie level, it's horrible. On a, you know, nutrient level, it's horrible. On pesticide and herbicide level, so pretty much anything you compare to that is going to be better. But when people talk about things with pesticides and herbicides, up until relatively recently, we really haven't had a whole lot of research showing that some of these things are contributing to some of our chronic health problems. But now we're starting to see some evidence that a lot of the chronic health problems, now I'm not talking about you eating a vegetable and getting sick right away, or even a week later, you know, nothing like that. What I'm talking about is, you know, you're 40 years old and boom, you have an autoimmune disorder, or, you know, you get cancer in your 70s, or you get heart disease or diabetes when maybe you're not even overweight, but you start to get those things. Like, these are chronic issues that are becoming so much more prevalent today. And many experts are connecting it, not to the fact that we overeat, but more so even to the quality of our food and the things like antibiotic use, pesticide use, herbicide use, and the other chemicals and stuff that we put in our food that have these long-term effects, which, you know, are terrible. They're terrible. And they're generational. For example, when we consume products that contain like glyphosates or, you know, have been used with pesticides, the first generation to consume them will have some effects to their microbiome diversity. But that microbiome is what gets passed on to our offspring, and we're seeing a reduction in diversity with each successive generation, to the point now where, I mean, when we were kids, people were eating shitty, just like they are now, but we didn't see food allergies like we do now. Why are food allergies all of a sudden starting to explode? Well, it starts to happen on a generational basis. This is a big fucking problem. So I think it's smart for you to choose organic foods that, you know, have no synthetic pesticides or lower, you know, loads of things like glyphosates. But I think it's also very smart for your kids, for their health, and then for the future, because by giving your money to these organizations that produce these products, you're showing the market that there's more of a demand, and think more companies like Thrive Market will come out and will produce these products at lower prices. So, you know, support what you want to see more of.
That's it.
And I think that's something that everybody can benefit from.
Next question is from Christopher Boy Semba. What are your thoughts on the growing popularity of nootropic foods?
Here we go.
Yeah, here we go is right.
Nootropic market is the...
It's exploding right
now. It's the new, like, supplement market, right?
It's the new pre-workout.
Brain food.
It's what pre-workout was 5 years ago. Mm. You know, it's become that, and it's annoying me as much as that is, too. And, you know, we have coffee, Chimera, that has nootropics already in it, right? So... It doesn't mean that I'm like, oh, there isn't benefits to it, or, oh, I don't see this, that I think it's all bad, or it's whatever. It's the hype behind it. Mm-hmm. It's like, what you don't hear us saying is about, like, Chimera coffee is going to change your life. It's going to be, once you get these nootropics in you, your workouts are going to be way better than they've ever been. It's like, oh,
it's like cereal laced with creatine.
They make that, I bet.
Like, cool.
Can this stuff help? Is it give you a little bit of an edge? Like, sure, I guess if all other things considered, right? Like if your sleep was good.
Yeah, I was going to say, here's a nootropic for you. Get good sleep.
Right. You know what I'm saying? Like if you've slept really well, if you've got your workouts in, you've eating a balanced diet, you're doing all these things that you should be doing first, hydrated, yada, yada. And then on top of that, you add this nootropic to give you this extra sharp, you know, focus whenever it is.
Here's what I don't. So here's the nootropic market's interesting because there are what are considered natural nootropics, which are just compounds that you find in nature, like alpha GPC, theanine is an amino acid that you can combine with caffeine that can give you a kind of a better, you know, buzz, if you will. There's a few others that are natural out there, but then there's this whole market that's exploding with synthetic nootropics. There's the class
of... Which I am not a fan of.
There's the racetam class of chemicals like piracetam, aniracetam, oxiracetam, phenylracetam. There's so many, you know, racetams now, I can't even keep up with them. Then there's Nupept. Then there's like prescription drugs that some people will promote, like modafinil and some others. And then some people will say things like
nicotine.
And... Yeah, nicotine can have some nootropic effects. Here's how I feel about synthetic nootropics. It's the same way I feel about synthetic anything. Sometimes they're fun. Sometimes they can give you a boost. Definitely don't use them all the time.
Sometimes they give you a headache.
I do not subscribe to the trend right now where they're saying take these synthetic nootropics all the time because they're good for your brain.
Definitely don't.
I don't subscribe to that. I'm sorry. No. I don't believe that. I don't believe taking anything synthetic is good for your brain unless it's treating a particular, you know, problem that you have or something.
Yeah.
I don't think it's a good idea. And my experience with synthetic nootropics is. They're a lot of fun. I respond really well to them. I definitely can find myself feeling a little speedy, a little sharper, it feels like. My verbal fluency seems to improve and increase. The problem that I notice is I build a
tolerance
to it.
Quick.
Really quick, I build a tolerance, and I notice a withdrawal when I start to go off of them. That tells me right away that my body is trying to adapt to this synthetic product, which is not... That's not a good thing because that means I'm downregulating something and I'm reducing the production of something that's natural in my brain in order to, you know, as I continue to take these products. Not something I recommend long term. I really don't think it's a good thing. And you've got all these, we've had more Well, over the last
for sure
6 months, we've had more nootropic companies come after us than regular
Well, our name
companies.
Is kind of perfect for it, if you think about it.
Mind pump.
Well, it's such a tough thing for us, too, because every one of us experiment and have used it, right? And I think
they can be fun.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I think that's the hard thing.
They have their place. I like it, actually.
I feel like I can promise our listeners this. If there's anything that ever hits the market that is like game changing, you better fucking believe we'll be talking about it. Yeah. And we'll be talking about it like that. Like, holy shit, this has totally changed health and fitness. We've had nothing like this since the invention of creatine.
Well, it's just interesting. Everything is going now to the brain, right? Like, it's a lot of focus there, even with training. And so that's why, I mean, I'm actually experimenting with the Halo Sport headphones because, you know, with neural priming, I'm interested in it. Like, I just want to know, like, what that feels like, what kind of, like, sensation that's going to bring. Like, is that really going to have any kind of effect on any of my movement quality or, like, my adaptability as far as, like, complex movements, that kind of stuff. So, I don't know. You know, some things are, like, you know, obviously that's the 1% kind of people that will notice benefit, I'm sure, because, you know, going from already having all those things set in place and ready to go and like operating efficiently, now I can kind of experiment and see, like, is this something else?
I always feel like two people, it's like if you have the finances, right? If you have the finances, you have the discipline to be like a Ben Greenfield, where you really like are taking care of like all the major things, and then you like to experiment with these things, like and you have money, and it's like, who cares if I spend? Because I tell you what, the thing that I think is really fascinating about the nootropic market right now is it's expensive as fuck for something that doesn't even come close to working like a lot of other things do. So
it's the promises that are attached to it that's gross.
Yes, yeah. So that's. You know, but if you got the money, right? Like, if you got the money to spend on something like that, then why not? And as long as you use it responsibly, and you take some of the advice that Sal's saying right now, that be careful that you take a synthetic version of that, because I think there's a difference between synthetic ones and then ones that we find in nature that are natural.
Even some of the natural ones, like choline. You know, high doses of choline over long periods of time may not necessarily be good for you if you're a man for prostate. In fact, they might have connected it to some enlargement issues there. So you got to look at everything and pay attention to, like, with natural stuff, am I going to take too much of it? Typically natural is typically better for the body. It has less chance of these kind of, you know, problems that may arise, but that doesn't mean they're devoid of them. But synthetic in particular, you know, I'll tell you what, with synthetic nootropics, it's definitely a sympathetic response. Like, when I take a synthetic nootropic, I get more hyper. Mm-hmm. Now, if you're somebody who is like, oh, I need to take a nootropic because I'm fatigued all the time, I don't have the energy to work, I need more focus, and the problem may be HPA axis dysfunction. Right. It may be that your body's not responding to cortisol the way it should. You're going to supplement something that's going to activate more of a sympathetic response.
Yeah, not a good idea.
You're kicking the can down the road. It's like,
set yourself back. Yeah,
you're going to create a situation where you'll get to a point where now you're taking nootropics, you're drinking caffeine, you're doing all these different things just to be normal, and then you start to feel shitty on them. What do? Up the dose. Now side effects come into play and all these other things. So I don't. And here's the other thing with synthetic with some of these nootropics is I'm not going to say which one because I'm not going to put them on blast. Because I like the people are nice and whatever and but if they push it too far, I will put them on blast. I got a sample at one of the last one of the last things that expos we went to of this product that was a nootropic, and it was full of these synthetic nootropics. Some of these were from the Racetem category of nootropics, and I'm looking at these. I'm like, I've never heard of these, and I'm pretty up and up in that world in terms of knowing the names and where they came from. And I'm like, what are these? Like, so I went online and I started doing my research. One of them was produced by I think it was a Japanese pharmaceutical company. They abandoned it. So they made it and they never got it to market because it didn't pass certain trials. They didn't see. And it was like, there was like three ingredients in there that were like that. And I'm like, so here's these pharmaceutical companies that invented this, decided not to go through compounds with producing them. Because either it wasn't efficacious or it had too many side effects or was too expensive or something, right? They just decided we're not going to bring it to market. These, this nootropic company, this supplement company, is scouring these journals for obscure chemicals that they can
create.
Isn't
that like the pro-hormone?
That's
like,
how pro-hormones.
Yeah, that's how they got to
that's how they got real big in that whole gray market, is they were scouring the market for these abandoned chemicals that they could produce, and it's all gray market because legally you can't, you're not legally able to sell them to humans. You have to literally say not for human consumption. Although they are now. You are now seeing them say, oh, it's for people. Take them twice a day, three, because nobody's saying shit to them. But the time is going to come. I guarantee you that someone's going to come, you know, the FDA is going to come crashing down on them pretty soon because they're pushing the limit.
That was a perfect example of what Justin just said. It's exactly like the pro-hormone phase. When I remember that, like yesterday, when we could go down to your local Max Muscle or whatever, or vitamin place, and go get behind the counter a supplement that
one testosterone,
right? And it was one molecule different from the real testosterone, right? And so
they were actual, though they weren't pro hormones, because pro hormones are are compounds that your body turns into hormones, so it's a pro hormone. These were actual designer steroids. I know, I bought them, I took them,
right?
It was literally a steroid, and the funny thing is,
with all the side effects,
worse. Yeah. So I took one. I'll never forget. I took Superdrol. Superdrol was one of the big ones. Methyl Masterdrol, Superdrol, Halidrol, one testosterone. I remember taking these, and it was like, oh fuck! Like, what is going on here? Like, within a week, it was like, I built all this muscle. I was holding all this water, lots of strength. So I'm kind of like, and I'm very analytical. So I'm trying to figure out what's going on, and I thought it was a pro hormone because that's how they market them. And I'm learning that these are actual designer steroids. But the reason why they were never even produced by pharmaceutical companies is they were harsher on the liver. They were harsher in terms of side effects than like Dianabol and Anadrol, which are some of the steroids that are not good for
you. My first bout of gynecomastia came from over the counter. I had taken steroids before that, didn't have any side effects yet in my life. I took two rounds, okay, back-to-back bottles of the what was the other one that was popular?
I don't know. There's one testosterone. There's methyl masterdrol.
No. Later. It's
Epistane.
No. God damn it. This is going to piss me off. I can't think of the name of it.
There was
Trinabol.
Something?
There was one that was actually
Trinabol.
Yeah.
So it was the Trin, and I think it was like Trinex was the brand or some shit.
It's like Trenbolone, but it's not.
Yes, right. And it was just, and I took two rounds of that, two bottles. Because the first bottle, I was blown away by the results.
Like, oh shit, this is over the counter?
Yes. So ran back, bought another one right away. And then that was the first time I'd ever experienced gynecomastia. So yeah, no, there. And then what they do is, sooner or later, enough of those cases come forward. So then finally the FDA comes in, puts a stop to it, and says, hey, this is now in the steroid category. So now that one is banned. Then the next person comes and changes one more molecule from it. You know what I'm saying? Like just a little bit different.
Cat and mouse game.
Yeah, it's a cat and mouse game. And they just keep playing that game because in that short amount of time, they can make enough money. It's not a big deal for it to get wiped off the counter,
Until the entire market for it is no more.
I think we're seeing the same thing with nootropics. I think people are starting to push the boundaries to get more and more like the movie Limitless.
I'm sure they're already on to the next, blend or whatever.
Dude, let me tell you something. With some of these nootropics, some of these synthetic nootropics, we are already getting reports of neuropathy in some people where they're getting tingling in their face or their fingertips. Oh, wow. Or
didn't you say one of them had blinding effects to it?
Oh, no, that was a SARM. That was a SARM, which is another, right. It's the same thing. Like it's that whole like gray market. We're going to sell some shit that we don't know what's going to do and people are going to take it. But no, there's a nootropic. Well, it's a nootropic, right? But it's called adrafinil, which gets converted to modafinil in the body. Modafinil is a prescription, so you can't buy it over the counter because you have to get prescribed. You get it prescribed, and it's like what they would give like fighter pilots to stay awake when they were doing their missions and shit.
Super Adderall or something.
It's a wakefulness agent, right? I know Dave Asprey. Raves about it, but not something you should fucking
Dave
take.
Dave recommends that.
Oh yeah.
What the fuck?
Oh, yeah.
Really?
Modafinil, he talks about
that's
it all.
That's fucking irresponsible.
He talks about it all the time.
Unbelievably irresponsible.
So adrafinil is a compound that gets converted to modafinil by the liver. It's gray market, so you can buy it over the counter. Oh, one of the major side effects of it is you can get the, facial tics that never go away. So it's
oh,
just
shit.
It's like if you
the
dig
that keeps on giving.
You got to dig deep enough and do some research and go on like page 2 of Google, cuz page 1 is like fucking owned
by all the
people trying to sell it.
Right.
Yeah. So everything you're going to read is like why it's so good for your they will literally tell you that not only is it going to give you nootropic benefits, which okay, you can make an argument that it might give you some benefits there. But they'll tell you it's good for you. Like, oh, this is something you should always take because it's really good for your brain. I'm like, I don't know about that. That might not be a good idea.
Yeah, that's the scary part.
Next question is from Johnny Dumbbells.
Hey
my boy.
Johnny Dumbbells.
Hey.
How long does it take without training to see noticeable muscle loss?
3 days after recovery. And that's a total arbitrary number, but it's pretty damn accurate. It's pretty, like all the studies.
Your body is always, it's constantly adapting.
Yep.
So there really is no... Like if you work out and you're at a high level and you've built like muscle and you're reaching kind of your genetic limit and you're training and you're like, oh, I'm just maintaining now. No, what you're doing is you're shrinking and building.
Yeah.
Stay at that level.
Do you know, and people don't realize this, that this is, and this is the shitty truth, that the more buff, it is the shitty truth. Yeah. The more buff you are, the more muscle you've had to, and the more volume you've had to create in your training in order to get to the size you are. The faster it goes the other direction.
Oh.
Because if you've done, like, because we all have like this genetic potential, right? And if you're pushing the upper echelon of your genetic potential, your body really is more comfortable back down in the smaller place, right? So it will, and if you don't, if you're not sending that signal and you're not stimulating it and you're not hitting that volume, the minute you lay off of it, so, and that's why I say 3 days from recovery. So let's say you just train, you know, legs really hard on Monday and it's now Thursday and you're not sore anymore, you're fully recovered. And now if you, let's say you don't work out legs anymore, atrophy's already set in. 3 days after that, it's already starting to happen.
Yeah, and there's definitely a genetic component there, but consider your body looks the way it does because of the signals you're sending it. So mm-hmm. once you stop sending those signals, your body has no need
we are a product
to do that
of our
anymore.
Environment.
You are. Yeah, now there are ways to achieve more, dare I say, for lack of a better term, permanent muscle. And there really is no way to have permanent muscle, but there are ways of training that will give you muscle that is more resilient to
sustainable muscle.
And that has to do with hyperplasia, muscle fiber hyperplasia. So when you lift weights to train to build muscle, you have muscle fiber hypertrophy. This is where the muscle fibers themselves thicken and grow so that they can contract harder. Over time, though, with volume, with lots of volume, especially frequency seems to be doing this the most, and long-term training. So like I've been doing this for 10 years now with this frequent type of, you know, signal, muscle fibers will actually split and you'll have one muscle fiber will become two muscle fibers. Now, those muscle fibers can grow and they can shrink, but once you've made more muscle fibers, the evidence suggests, because we don't know this for sure, but the evidence suggests that those muscle fibers don't go away.
I can for sure attest for personally, and then people that I know. Like, so once I had taken enough anabolics, I had been training for over 10 years of lifting consistently. I broke through this wall. I could never get to 200. Now, once I got over there and I pushed my body up to 230, you'll never see me get below 200. So I definitely know that I've seen, and I mean, not working out. Even if I were to not work out, I can still hold my body weight and muscle mass higher than where I was 15 years
ago.
Yeah,
it's interesting because even Dr. Andy Galpin, when he was here and talking about, because he actually does like biopsies and like sees like real tangible evidence sometimes that, you know, that this does occur.
Look at Ben Pekulski.
Yeah.
Ben Pekulski.
Oh, what a great example.
Ben Pekulski.
He's fucking
trying to get small.
He's trying to.
Yes.
He's lost a lot of muscle. He's not nearly as big as he was when he was competing, but he's way bigger than most people will ever be.
Well, he's 300.
Is he losing muscle?
He used to be 300 pounds. I think he's now down to like 270 or some 250 or somewhere like that. And the guy's like training once to three times a week. He's like
restricting calories.
Yeah, yeah. He's eating once to two times a day. That's it.
Like, now you know where you see this a lot. You see this when you meet. I'll never forget. Like this is when I had my personal training studio. This old guy walks in who was in his 80s or late 70s. He was eating breakfast next door because my gym used to be next to this popular breakfast joint. So he walked by, he looked in, he must have seen the weights, and he walks in. And he's this shorter dude, kind of stocky, but I could tell he's in his 70s or 80s. So he walks in, I shake his hand, and he's got this fucking meat hand, like this thick meat hand, and these little forearms that were just muscular. And I'm like, oh, man. I'm like, you know, what's your name? And I don't remember what his name was. He's Russian guy. He's like Vasily or whatever. I'm like, oh, you know, he's like, oh, I see you have kettlebell. And he's like fucking with the kettlebell. And I'm hanging out with the guy because I love talking to like old timers who used to work out. And I'm assumed that this dude lifts weights every day because of the way he looked. I assumed he worked out. So I'm like, hey, I'm like, so how often do you lift weights? He's like, oh, I haven't lift weights for 40 years. I'm like, what do you mean you haven't lift weights for 40 years? He goes, no, I don't lift. I don't do anything anymore. But he used to be a competitive weightlifter and coach for weightlifters. This guy did weightlifting in the Soviet Union for a long time, stopped working out years ago, but he's just got this permanent like muscle on his hands and forearms that you can tell was from gripping the weights. I also see this with like my dad who works construction, or he's retired now, doesn't do it anymore, but he's still got like remnants.
It's like you built it, but they're still functioning, you know, with those same muscle fibers. So it's like, you know, it sort of like maintains that level that you're at. It's crazy.
No, there's definitely something to be said about that. And I think, you know, giving those examples are for Ben Pakulski to me is like such a glaring example of that. Like he's trying to lose, right? Like, he's like trying to lose as hard as he can. And it's just, and I can see the way his frame is shaping up that it'll never all go away.
His legs are so massive. And he barely trains them anymore.
Yeah.
And that was his calling card when he was a pro, right? These massive wheels. His legs are fucking, like if you put like my legs with Justin's legs, they are probably the same size as his.
Probably, it's probably, you know, equal.
It's probably equal. Yeah, so
you and me.
Yeah, so, you know, your body, I mean, I guess the takeaway from this is your body's constantly adapting to your environment, to what you're doing. When you stop exercising, your body will adapt in that direction. The good news is this. The good news is of all the adaptations that you lose, strength, you tend to lose slower than things like stamina and endurance. Like if you're an endurance athlete or you train for stamina and you don't train for a week, you'll lose fucking stamina pretty damn quick. Yeah. I remember when I wouldn't do jiu-jitsu for a week, I'd go back.
You also get it. You also get it quick too, though.
You do, and you gain it quick.
Yeah,
strength can take a little time. You can keep strength for a little while. Like if I stop lifting weights and after 2 weeks and I go back, like I'm going to have a decent amount of strength, you know, left and you know, with my workouts.
Just like overall maintenance of fast twitch movement in general, you know, to maintain that sort of response. Like if you just lose that response, you know, you will lose it for, you know, it'll be hard to get back. So.
That's why it was always crazy to me when people were like, oh, I don't want to get big muscle because then if I stop working out, it's all going to go away. And I'm like, well, no shit. Of course it's going to go away. What are you talking about? Like you want to work out once and then never.
Right. The idea is to keep. It's funny that a lot of people think that way, though. The idea is to keep working out, right?
Yeah, that's the idea. So check this out. Go to YouTube, Mind Pump TV. You have to see what Justin just put up on that channel. There's a new video every single day. Also, if you go to mindpumpmedia.com, you can register for 30 days of coaching, and it costs nothing. It's free.
I'm wearing juicy pants this time.
Thank you for listening to Mind Pump. If your goal is to build and shape your body, dramatically improve your health and energy, and maximize your overall performance, check out our discounted RGB Super Bundle at mindpumpmedia.com. The RGB Super Bundle includes MAPS Anabolic, MAPS Performance, and MAPS Aesthetic, 9 months of phased expert exercise programming designed by Sal, Adam, and Justin to systematically transform the way your body looks, feels, and performs. With detailed workout blueprints and over 200 videos, the RGB Super Bundle is like having Sal, Adam, and Justin as your own personal trainers, but at a fraction of the price. The RGB Super Bundle has a full 30-day money-back guarantee, and you can get it now plus other valuable free resources at mindpumpmedia.com. If you enjoy this show, please share the love by leaving us a 5-star rating and review on iTunes and by introducing Mind Pump to your friends and family. We thank you for your support, and until next time, this is Mind Pump.